Hey, family. Praise the Lord. This is Minister Presley. I'm so glad you decided to join the Abyssinian Baptist Church Virtue Sunday morning service here in Philly for the Word of God that will resurrect your soul and convince, convict, and convert you. Because it's not what you have done. It's because of what Jesus has done for you at the cross. God bless you. Enjoy.
Oh, how he loves you. Say,
oh, what love
he has for
Let's encourage them. That's love. They did an excellent job.
Yes, it did.
Showing visually about what the Lord Jesus did for us. They hung him high. They stretched him wide. He bowed his head. For me, he died. That's love. And I'm so glad that that's not how the story ends. He's coming back for me again, for us again. That's love. That's that agape love. That's that love that because of. He loved us so much. For while we were yet sinners, Christ died. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only one of a kind son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Thank you, choir, for reminding us. What kind of love is this? Your mind can't even comprehend this type of love.
It's time to be blessed. It's time to give. Or we can do better than that. Think about all that God has done for you. He protects you. He provides for you. And he even preserves you. The least we can do is worship him through our giving. This is all a part of our worship. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 9:7, it says that each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And even though we may not be at the church physically, we can still participate in our giving. We have four ways that we give. Our first way is that you can simply go to our website, abyssinianbc.com /give-online. Our second option is that you can give through our app Easy Tithe, which is found in your Play Store or your App Store on your smart devices. The third way is you can simply just drop off your offering at Abyssinian Baptist Church. Our address is 4210 Germantown Avenue, and our stewards will handle your offering. Fourthly and lastly is we want to make sure that we can be a blessing to our pastor. Our pastor, Dr. Pointer, is not on a salary per se, but he's trusting God to touch the hearts of his people to bless him and his family. And he has two options. One, you can simply give through Cash App. His handle is $.241. And you can also designate your giving to pastor through your Easy Tithe as well. We have a plethora of ways to give, and we want to just personally thank everyone who has been giving already. We ask God to continue to bless and keep you. And we also want to thank God for those that will give as well. We also ask God to bless and keep you as well. We thank you. God bless you. And heaven smile upon you. Amen.
Good morning. We thank God for Resurrection Sunday. We thank God for allowing us to gather together in that name that's above every other name, and that's the name of Jesus. We greet you. I greet you today, and I'm telling you, I'm so glad in spite of the pandemic, in spite of all of what's going on, God still is in control. I know I have some of you that most, if not all of you, that will bear witness to the fact that God is, if it had not been for the Lord on our side, even up to this point, where would we be? This morning, I want to begin our lesson, Matthew chapter 16, beginning at verse 24. Actually, it's going to be two passages in Matthew. Matthew chapter 16, and then we'll go to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 16, beginning at verse 24. And both of the passages in Matthew will be the New Living Translation. Matthew chapter 16, beginning at verse 24. We'll give you a moment to get there, and then let's see what God has to say to us on this Resurrection Sunday. Matthew chapter 16, verse 24, I'm reading, says, "Then Jesus said to his disciples, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross," don't miss that, "and follow me." Verse 25 of Matthew chapter 16 says, "If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it." Amen. Matthew 28, beginning at verse 1. Matthew 28, beginning at verse 1. Verse 1 says, "Early on Sunday morning," preachers know what that early is, "as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb." Verse 2 says of Matthew 28, "Suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat on it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow." Verse 4, "The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. Then the angel spoke to the women. 'Don't be afraid,' he said." That's very important. "I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified." Verse 6, "He isn't here. He's risen from the dead, just as he said would happen. Come see where his body was lying. And now go quickly and tell his disciples," verse 7, "that he has risen from the dead and he is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you." Verse 8 says, "The women ran quickly from the tomb. They were very frightened, but also filled with great joy. And they rushed to give the disciples the angel's message." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. I want to talk around the subject this morning. For every resurrection, there's a cross to bear. For every resurrection, there is a cross to bear. Understand, there is no resurrection or Easter Sunday without the experience of a Good Friday. Conversely, there's no Good Friday without having to bear a cross. Understand, theologically, we have to keep Good Friday and Easter together. A Good Friday without Easter is doom and despair. In other words, on Good Friday, there was pain, suffering, and a crucifixion and death took place. And on Easter, Resurrection Sunday, without Good Friday, it's empty sentiment. It's just a whole lot of drama. In other words, you can't have one without the other. And we have to remember what Jesus did on the cross on Friday was the fulfillment of God's eternal plan for the whole world. In other words, Jesus had to die. Yes, he did. The Bible explains he had to pay the consequences for your sins and mine so that we might have life. Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday has eternal consequences. And we have our portion of pain and discomfort to bear also. Oftentimes we think, you know, what did he do, or what don't I have? I don't want to go through anything. Well, if you belong to the Lord, you're going to have to bear a cross too. I like what the hymnologist wrote. "Must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone and there's a cross for me." It's the pastor's, it's the spiritual leader's responsibility to tell the truth to his or her people. There's a Good Friday for all of us. See, many people, can I be truthful? Many people have a problem with the cross. The very idea of Good Friday causes concern for so many people. The problem is that both his power and wisdom led him to the cross, which is a seemingly, I said a seemingly confliction with everything he had done before. Remember, this is the same Jesus that had raised the man Lazarus from the dead. This is the same Jesus who had healed a woman with a bleeding disorder issue. This is the same Jesus that had given sight to the blind. The same Jesus that had power and authority over the wind and the waves. This is the same Jesus. I'm talking about who's dying, who had to die on Good Friday. He had power and authority over the wind and the waves. He had exercised power and authority over the influence of demonic activity. This same Jesus, who claimed to be the Son of God, was the same Jesus who was now seemingly unable or unable to save himself. In other words, the problem was those who had seen his power demonstrated wondered why now, at this time, Good Friday, he seemed to be powerless at his greatest time of need. I guess that would have some of us to think. The same Jesus that had demonstrated all of this power, all of this control over the nature and the wind, the waves, now couldn't save himself. But both sides miss what Jesus and his Father were saying. The Bible says in John chapter 12, verse 24, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground, I'm reading the Bible, and dies, it abides alone. But if it dies, it produces many. Notice not just his words, but the life of Jesus is a parable. You know what a parable is, don't you? When we talk about a parable, it's a simple story used to illustrate a moral or spiritual lesson. You know, everything works out for the good, and God has purpose for everything. And there are people that we speak to week after week that have a problem with the cross. Religious-minded people want miracles and power. Yeah. Intellectually minded people want wisdom and truth. But what God offers us is first the cross. See, the earliest believers, they called the cross the wisdom of God and power of God. Remember 1 Corinthians, I believe it, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning at verse 23. It says, but we preach Christ, listen, crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. Verse 24 of 1 Corinthians chapter 1 says, but to those whom God has called, both the Jew and the Greek, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Notice it's a stumbling block for people to consider even today in 2020. The fact that both his power and wisdom led him to the cross. And so many people find it difficult to connect Jesus with power and glory and at the same time acknowledge him as a suffering Savior. Wait a minute. This same God that's able to demonstrate all this power and glory, now he's suffering at the hands of mortal beings, mortal humanity. In other words, people who are already suffering for the most part don't want to hear sermons about a suffering Savior. People who are already suffering don't want to hear about their Savior suffering. Can I get a witness? I repeat, Good Friday, listen, marks the beginning of change. It's an opportunity to proclaim the sacrifice of Jesus on our behalf. In other words, once you've been to the cross, everything changes. I wish I had some witnesses. Once you get to the cross or been there, everything changes. Stumbling blocks and foolishness turn into power and wisdom. I'm talking about once you've been to the cross. See, notice and understand what Jesus did for you and me on the cross changes everything. When he died, he paid the penalty for your sins and mine. And John, 1 John chapter 2, verse 2 says, he is, here's the word, propitiation, or the atoning sacrifice for your sins and mine. And not only for yours and mine, but also, the Bible says, for the sins of the whole world. In other words, this should make all the difference concerning our priority and our perspective. I'm talking about when we understand what the cross meant for you and I, when we understand the significance of the cross, when we understand the connection between the cross and Resurrection Sunday, it ought to make a difference between our priority and our perspective. In other words, if nothing is changing, maybe you haven't been to the cross. If nothing has changed or is changing in your life, I'm talking about the people that say, I'm saved, I'm blood washed, I'm born again, you know, all of the church related words. But yet there's no difference in your thinking, then there's something wrong. I said, the cross, when you connect the cross and Resurrection Sunday, the cross and what happened, the significance of what Jesus did and what it says to both of them. I like the song that says, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. The songwriter said, it was there at the cross. By faith, I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. What a beautiful song. And I repeat, for every resurrection, there's a cross to bear. And once again, I say Resurrection Sunday or Easter is indeed about, listen, an empty tomb. But first, it's about the cross. Why are we so much in a hurry to rush Jesus up to heaven? Is it because the cross just doesn't fit into your picture of how things ought to be? It didn't fit into anybody's picture back then either. See, Friday is the road to Sunday. You got to get to Friday, and you got to go through Friday in order to get to Sunday. It's the road for you and I today. See, you and I can best appreciate the resurrection. You know, let me just park here for a moment. Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. For many people, it's about Easter bunnies, buying clothes, showing our wear, Easter eggs, jubilee, fanfare, all of those things. And with the coronavirus, things are shut down. And because you can't celebrate as the world usually celebrates, and even Christians, clothing and fine attire, eating out and spending money and all that, does that take away from the significance of Resurrection Sunday or Easter? It shouldn't. Perhaps God has allowed, and I didn't say he did it, but he's allowed things to happen so that we might be able to see whether or not we're authentic in our conversion experience. Because with or without a new suit or new dress, the resurrection is more important and it's more significant. It's more than about clothing, and it's more about than about Easter eggs, and it's nothing to do with an Easter bunny. I said the coronavirus, the deaths and the possibility of infection, the economic crisis, the loss of jobs and income that have forced shut-ins and shutdowns has made families come together and to look again to the God of heaven and our Lord Jesus Christ. There's been emotional challenges, psychological challenges, physiological challenges, spiritual stress, and even trauma. It's a type of cross bearing. The Bible says on Good Friday, Jesus was beaten, mocked, struck on the head with a staff, spit upon, crown of thorns was placed on his head, and he was stripped naked. He was made to carry, listen, his own cross. But when he grew too weak, Simon of Cyrene was forced to carry it for him. You know the story. He was led to Calvary. They drove nails into his wrists and ankles, nailed him to the cross. Then an inscription, people don't know what they're saying. They had an inscription that said, that read, King of the Jews, was placed over his head. And he hung on the cross for approximately 6 hours, the Bible says, until he took his final breath. But while he was on the cross, soldiers cast lots for his clothing. And onlookers shouted insults and jeered. I'm on my way now from Good Friday to Resurrection Sunday. The Bible says two criminals were crucified at the same time. Darkness blanketed the land, and the Bible says Jesus gave up his spirit. And at that moment, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, rocks split apart, and tombs opened. But wait a minute, that's not how the story ends. Because we just looked at Matthew chapter 28, verse 1 says, Early, that's a key word. Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Verse 6 of Matthew 28 says, he isn't here. They were looking for a tomb, but he isn't here, the Bible says. He is risen from the dead, just as he said it would happen. Come see where his body was lying. And that brings us to the Resurrection Sunday. Can I get a witness? There are 3 points about the good news of the resurrection Easter Sunday, and then we'll all be done. 3 points I want to look at here in Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 to 8. The comfort, the challenge, and the command. Do I need to repeat that? The comfort, the challenge, and the command. The comfort is found in verse 6 because it's in there. It says, be calm. You need to understand that having already experienced the events of the previous days, the women were filled with fear and anxiety. I'm talking about they had experienced the arrest, the crucifixion, and his burial, and the fact that they had left all to follow him. Their hearts were already troubled over the death of their Lord. The Bible says, significant, in spite of all that's going on, there's a call to be calm. Their hearts were heavy. And I can only imagine becoming more troubled as they approached the tomb early in the morning. But the message, again, of the resurrection and the empty tomb is to stay calm. Come hell or high water, for lack of better words. Through all that's going on, stay calm. Have faith. Don't be troubled or worried. Not only stay calm, but there was courage in place at the resurrection of Jesus. Be courageous, the Bible says. The message of the resurrection should give you and I courage. It should instill courage in your heart and mind. Why? Because death was defeated for all who believe in Jesus. When you get a chance, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 53 to 57. It lets us to know that death is no longer our enemy, but is a friend to the child of God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1, it says, here we go, for we know, there's some things you ought to know, child of God. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Not only in our comfort to stay calm and have courage, but there's something else in verse 6. It says, be confident. Hebrews chapter 13, 6 says, so we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me? And in verse 6 of Matthew 28, listen, the angel's command is fear not. Why? Because God's promises are real and certain. Yes, they are. His words are true. We can count on him. He will do what he says. I wish I had some witnesses. Every promise that the Lord has made, he can and will keep. But not only point number one, the comfort, there's point number two, the challenge. It's in verse 6. A challenge to examine. Verse 6 says, come and see the place where the Lord lay. That's an invitation, my brothers and sisters, to examine the claim of the resurrection or the resurrected Lord. He isn't here, the Bible says. He's risen from the dead. Hallelujah. Just as he said he would. Come see where his body, the Bible says, was lying. I repeat, it's a challenge to examine. I'm talking about to examine your faith. There's a whole lot of people talk faith. But you need to determine, is your faith weak or strong? The Hebrew writer said, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Am I right about it? It's also a challenge to experience. Remember, the message of the angel who rolled the stone away is also an invitation to experience. Yeah, it is. What better way to really relate and connect with our suffering Savior now, a resurrected Savior, than to experience some things? Notice the word, it says, come see. And the word see means to know. Jesus not only wants you to believe in the resurrection, but he wants you to know him, to experience him in a personal way. Not only comfort and not only the challenge, but lastly, point number three as a close. Verse 7 of Matthew 28 is a command. It says not to be just a hearer, but a doer of God's word. I wish I had some doers up in here today. In other words, verse 7, we have the command of this good news. And I'm talking about the message of Easter and the resurrection. Once we have experienced the resurrection, once we have come and once we have seen, the Bible commands us to go and tell. Verse 7 of Matthew 28 says, and now go quickly, I'm reading the Bible, and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And he is, listen, very important, he is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you. Question for you and question for others that may be listening and tuning in. Question that I even ask. Why did Jesus want to meet them in Galilee? Good question. Now, there's no definitive answer, only speculation. But somebody says the reason Jesus said meet in Galilee, at least four reasons. I said it's not definitive. There's speculation, but it's a good speculation. Four reasons. One of them would be the Jews of that day had a belief that the soul of the departed hovered over the tomb for several days after death. And if Jesus met the disciples in Galilee, then there would be no suspicion that the post-resurrection appearances of Jesus was only a ghost. They would know for sure that he had risen. But then there's a second speculation, that this was a call to faith. I'll meet you in Galilee. Go there and I'll meet you there. It was a call to faith. Jesus had been warning them that he would be killed, but would rise from the dead. For them to go to Galilee, listen, with the purpose of meeting him there would be an act of faith. I know I'm right about it. Then thirdly, meeting in Galilee would allow Jesus, listen, it would allow Jesus to easily choose genuine witnesses concerning his resurrection. See, Galilee would be a good location to meet with his disciples alone without any interruption. And then fourthly, And I'm closing for real. Galilee was home for them. Jesus knew the psychological state of the disciples at that point. Surely they were broken and in despair, probably even frightened. Judas was dead. Thomas was alone in his own dark depression. The others were confused. And Jesus' goal would be to regroup them and reconstruct their faith. I don't know about you, but every now and then I get pounded by the world's bad messages and devastation and bad news. But every now and then I need the Lord to step in my life and reconstruct, regroup, and refocus my faith. Can I get a witness? Let me give an example. Whenever a young person's life is in turmoil or trouble and they need to find a place of security, most of the times they go back home. Can I get a witness? Home is where they find security. I know you left them there on their own. They couldn't wait to get out. But when hell breaks out and when life begins to deal them a bad hand, oftentimes the door will open or the bell will ring and they'll say, I'm back. Home is where they find security. Home is where you have love and remembrance of the good old days. Home is where there's a sense of belonging. And Jesus, I believe, knew that taking them back to Galilee would help remind them of their time with Jesus. You know, happy times. They would remember in Galilee the successes. They would remember in Galilee the miracles. They would remember in Galilee the casting out of demons. They would remember in Galilee the healing of the sick. They would remember in Galilee the preaching to the multitudes. It would take them out of the hostile environment of Jerusalem, the place of conflict, the attacks of the Jewish leaders in the place of death. In Galilee, they would find it easier to see the mission of evangelizing the lost. My brothers and sisters, what about you today? Are you willing to go and tell somebody what Jesus has done for you? I'm talking about you. Are you willing today, this Resurrection Sunday, to go and tell somebody what Jesus has done for you in spite of coronavirus, in spite of pandemic, in spite of this close and that close, in spite of the seemingly more bad news to come? Are you able to go tell somebody that you know a Savior that's able to do anything but fail? But wait a minute. When you go and tell them, let this song be on your mind and in your heart, because we've not always had the opportunity or been privileged to call on a Savior that never fails. The songwriter said, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea, he heard my despairing cry and from the waters lifted me. Now safe, safe, safe am I. Will you say yes today to the Lord? What about you today? What does the resurrection mean for you today? I'll tell you what it means. It means that Christ's death, burial, and resurrection has given you and I a chance for our sins to be forgiven. It's given us an opportunity for heaven to be our eternal home. If you haven't already done so, say this prayer with me today. Dear Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. I'm talking about if you really want Jesus as your Savior, if you want your eternal home to be in heaven with a God who's already done everything to save you. Ask God and acknowledge, Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sins, and I accept the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. My brothers and sisters, let us continue our celebration, Resurrection Sunday. But you know what? I found out we're not just saved from the penalty of our sins. God is still in the business of saving. saving us from our hurts, saving us from our wounds, saving us from our doubts, saving us when we're feeling left behind, saving us when we've been rejected, saving us when we need, saving us when we don't have need, saving us when everybody else throws us in. God is still a Savior. Thank God for Resurrection Sunday. Thank God for Jesus. God bless you, and heaven smile upon you. To our ABC Church family and friends, we truly hope this message has been a blessing to you and your family. We look forward to sharing God's word with you again in the near future. Because of the coronavirus, we're not able to gather together in one local assembly, but audio and video technology allows us to come together. To God be the glory. You know we support our church and its ministries by our giving through tithes and love offerings support for me, your pastor. To give, please click on the links below. Again, please stay encouraged. Remember Psalms 46 says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in our time of trouble. God bless you. Thank you.